everyone, it's Chris Reese from Padoon here. How are you doing? I hope you're all doing well. Today's exercise basically is all about cables and cable management. And what we're going to do is strip the system down completely, turn it around to show you what it's all about, and show you the cables and cable management and how best to fit them into the back of your system. I use a full loom of Siltech cables throughout, and I really think it's important to use a full loom so you don't add any other tonal qualities through the system. Today we're going to talk about RCA versus XLR, the lengths of cables as well. So I really hope you enjoy it. So just to show you the cables, I'm using Siltech Classic 770i, which is their anniversary range. I have three of those, one from the phono to the pre, one from the pre to the power, one from the CD to the pre. So the Classic 770i is the top of the Classic anniversary range. It's a silver and gold construction. Basically what that means is that silver has certain melting properties and you'll find tiny little pits in the metal. So because gold melts at a faster temperature, that fills in the divots or the little slivers left in the silver to make it a solid core cable, or it behaves like a solid core cable. Now you'll also notice that I'm using RCA. Now, there's a big debate whether RCA or XLR are the best ones to use. XLR has a higher voltage, it's better over a distance. Its shielding properties arguably are better, but with an Agra system, as I'm using, as you know, they do prefer you to use single-ended. So you may lose a little dynamics, but Nagra doesn't lack any dynamics. But what you gain, in my opinion, is a lot of musicality. So that's our choice to use RCA. Now here's the mains cables. They are the SPX 800s, and I've gone for the option of the higher quality plugs for the mains and for the IEC. And the Siltech mains cables are fantastic, low noise floors, just no noise coming from them at all. So I've been to the Siltech factory and we've shown tests on RF, and they are the lowest I've ever heard. So a very, very nice mains cable. And I'm only using two because we've got the Nagra power supply, which powers the CD, the pre, and the phono stage. So as you can see, the cables that I'm actually using through the system are all 1 meter long. This is a 1 meter cable. It's an RCA Siltech Classic Anniversary 770i. And I'm a firm believer that a cable is best designed over certain lengths. And 1 meter, I think, personally, is the sweet spot for a cable. This cable is nice and slim as well. So one thing you do get with shorter cables, if they are quite stiff, you're not going to get the system close to the wall as you'd like, because the cable then will foul with the equipment and push the equipment forward, so it won't sit correct. So a 1 meter cable is a preference, and you can tuck them in with them being like this into the back of the rack. There you go. And with regard to this bigger cable, I recommend, you know, a loose coil underneath the rack if it fits. As you can see, it's quite a long length there. I'm using a 5 meter pair. This one goes directly to the back of the speaker, just like that. And if we come over here, you can see that it's under the floor. We have a void there with a cable trap put in, and it comes out the other side, so it's nice and neat. You also may notice that I've got a bank of 4 sockets on the wall. Nothing special, really, but what I have got is a high-grade cable in the wall going back to the garage, and it has its own consumer board and, basically its own mains for the system, which is nice and clean and no noise. Very important. Okay, so one thing you'll notice on the Classic Anniversary range or any Siltech range is they are obviously directional. It tells you what the cable is, serial numbers, etc. And that's the way that the cable flows. Okay, so also we have on here with the RCAs, they are lockable. Okay, so you can twist them to lock and the other way to unlock. Okay, so we'll be locking those back in. So we start at the top with the CD player. And as you'll see, the left and right's there and there. One cable at a time. Left cable in. Lock him up. Drape it down the back. Right cable in. Lock him up. And follow the left. Now this cable will go into the back of the pre. So the left is on the top, input one, right, input one, left and right, lock him up, and that's the CD player plumbed in. Now, as you'll see, we've got the drape here, and we're lucky enough to have some space in the rack if we wanted to turn and shove the cables in there. But we'll leave all that till last after it's all ready to go, okay? Next, the final stage. Right in, left in. Let's give it a shove, just so. Tighten them up and drape them down the back. And then we go to the preamplifier. Right into input two. Left into input two. Screw them up nice and tight. They're not going to go anywhere. And you'll see the drapes are following each other. Just one little bit longer than the other. So the last interconnect in is pre to power. In we go, on the right and the left. Follows down to the power, and there's your left, there's your right. Screw them up nice and tight. And that's the system pretty much wired up now. We've got to add the DC cables and the speaker cables and mains cables last. So as you can see, I've added the DC cables in to the system to power up on the Niagara power supply. It's a 4 output in one. And then down to the preamp as well. I've had to do this separately because they're quite hard to put in, and you can't hold film and push a cable in at the same time. It's quite a difficult thing to do. Apologies for not showing you that, but they're just a push fit connection, but they do need homing in. Okay, so now you can see the whole back of the system, excluding the two power cables going in, because they've got to go in last, because it's up against the wall, and the speaker cables also. That's all the cabling into the back of the Niagara. Okay, and far from ideal. As you can see, it's quite a bit to lose, all right? But with the cable being thin, we can tuck it away, like I said previously. So we could get away with shorter lengths on reflection, but like I said, I do prefer a meter long. As you see, all the cables from the DC have gone under the power supply platform. They're all in a loose coil and they're all shielded. There's no interference there from one cable to another. And the same with the pre going to the power. The excess cable is under the preamplifier. So already starting to look a lot neater. And the excess from the phono stage, under the phono stage, and then down to the preamp. And the objective here is to keep the mains cables and signal cables away from each other. Also, I did mention that the Siltech cables are very, very low RF and the DC cables are shielded, but it's a force of habit. And again, the CD cables going under the CD platform, away from the other cables, all nicely in a row there, down to the preamp. And I'm also using a Siltech, which is the ST-IQ18 RCA cable, like one of our competition, or two of our competition, well, lucky winners won the other week. Fantastic cable. I use this for a Sonos Connect going into the system for the radio. Fantastic little cable, great value for money. So we have the tone table on the top, and that's ready to be wired up. And basically what we need to do, I've got the cables going down the wall there, but I prefer to get the rack in place before we put the turntable in, and I can tuck the cable away nicely. Makes more sense to do it that way. So here's a shot behind the system. You can see mains away from signal, all the signal cables together, and that's lovely and neat, and also dust-free. So the mains cables are in ready now, and on the far bank are sockets, purely because of the reason of I haven't got to look at them when I'm sitting down the other end of the room. A bit sad, I know, but you probably gathered that you know, you've got to have a good attention to detail when you're doing this anyway, so it all makes sense. It does to me anyway. And now you see the system is almost in final position. I just left myself enough room to get my hands behind to get the speaker cable in and the mains cable in, and we'll dress those as well. I've got to stress as well the importance, in my opinion, of using the same manufacturer to keep the same tonal balance through the design. I'm not one for mixing and matching cables of different manufacturers. When you use a full loom, it really comes into its own. You get the best from the cables when you're using that. Okay, so now we're going to put the mains cables in. There you go, so they're in. And you can see what I've done at the bottom there. Tuck them away. That won't interfere with the speaker cable because of its shielding properties, and it's going out of the way of the speaker cable there. But there's the mains cables in. So we've got the right speaker cable plugged in now. Quite fiddly, can't film that one because it's I'm a one-hand man here, so it's quite difficult to do that on your own. And you can see the coil ready now for the left speaker. So there's a right speaker that's plugged in, and now we're going to do the left speaker with this coil here. Okay, so that's both speakers plumbed in, and the coil is nice and loose underneath the rack there, as you can see. Okay, so it's the turntable to plug in now, and then we can push the rack back a tiny bit further. Lovely and neat. And there you are. Turntable's now in. Cable's plumbed into the back of the phono stage. And a nice neat drape with the earth and left and right down the back. And that's from this angle. Obviously got to put a mains lead in for the turntable. I'll do that in a sec. But that's a lovely neat job, if I may say so myself. And from the front, you can just see the cables under the platforms, but you don't see them when you're looking bang onto it. You've got to be really, really flat on. Okay. The mains cables in the MPS to power all the kit, apart from the power amplifier and mains cable in the power amp. Speaker cables in, DC cables in, all interconnect cables in, all present and correct. So now for the power up. So our main power, it's the MPS. Where is it? There we go. On he goes. Nice good voltage. Phono stage to mute. In readiness, that's flashing away. CD player is ready to go. And then down to the preamplifier. When I say heating, because there's valves in there. And now we leave the power amp until the preamp is heated up. So we've got a circuit there. Okay, so the power amp has gone on. No unpleasantness, so all's wired up well behind the back. We've taken the preamp off mute, selected CD just for speed. All's good with the power supply. Phonostage has stopped flashing. That means all that's all good as well. And the good old CD player is ready to go. So let's press play.